Iowa City. Just relax. Joan has been my wonderful, loving wife and partner for 62 years. She helped put me through graduate school in Berkeley. 7 years. She supported me in my work in Mexico City for 20 years. Nothing I have ever achieved would have been possible without her generous help and support. Where's my son Timothy? I hope he shows up, because I want to tell you about him. But I want to tell you about my daughter Sibley. Maybe you put your hand up, Sibley. Sibley Meadows Alcon. She came from Mexico City to be with us today. As some of you know, Sibley is the reason I discovered that a Montessori school was the best place, the best kind of school for children, especially for mine, because their lives were changed by it. After the primary teacher of where Sibley was going to school the American school in Mexico City was treating her badly because she couldn't learn to read. We discovered that she was dyslexic, and I began looking for a Montessori school. And I found one and enrolled both my children there, and they flourished there from then on. After her primary training, she grew up to become a Montessori teacher. She went to spend time with Dr. Elizabeth Caspari on Hilton Head Island to do part of her practicum there. Then she came back to our school in Mexico City to do it again, and did a whole other year because she wanted to make sure that she was going to do the best possible exam at the end. She is also a talented childbirth educator who has been inducted into the American College of Childhood and Childbirth Educators, the National Honor Society. And she has headed our Teacher Education Center in Mexico City since 1982. Now let me introduce my granddaughter. I have 5 grandchildren and 11 great-grandchildren. And my daughter is responsible for all of it. Put your hand up, Tamar. This is Tamar Alcon Meadows. She also came from Mexico City. How old were you when you got your MD, Tamar? 23. She got her MD degree in Mexico when she was 23 years young. She's a very bright young lady. And then she enrolled in the master's program at Eastern Virginia Medical School, where Dr. Howard Jones produced the first test tube baby in the U.S. in 1981 because she wanted to study in vitro fertilization, and only the best place to do it was good enough for her. So she applied among out of hundreds of other candidates and was only one of the very few that were accepted. And what was the year you got your master's?
3 years ago.
2 years ago. 2015. She got her master's. The one above MD. And then she came to Mexico, went to Mexico, and she's been doing in vitro fertilization there in a special hospital very successfully. And the university has invited her to be here to take her PhD at the university. And they're offering her a full diploma. And even though she's here, she's studying constantly and on her computer reviewing stuff because she has an exam yesterday. She had homework to turn in. She has an exam when? Tonight or tomorrow? Tomorrow. So when she's done during these little short intervals with us, she's studying for her exams and she's always gotten excellent grades because she has this marvelous memory that makes it possible for her to do such good work. You met my good friend Michael Tutterow, who is my pastor at the Heritage Baptist Church in Cartersville, and we thank you for coming and being part of our time. Gauru Suda, put your hand up, Gauru. They saw you a while ago. There she is. I was preparing teachers for the bilingual programs that I was able to start at the Unified School District in Irvine. And keep your seat, my dear. Just wanted to make sure they knew who you were. And I was preparing the second group. We prepare teachers, bilingual teachers, for Chinese, Japanese, Korean, Vietnamese, Farsi, and Spanish-speaking children in the communities around Irvine, California. I was teaching at the University of California, Irvine, and I was ready to teach the second group. I taught the Hispanics and the Chinese, and I wanted to get Japanese and Farsi and others going. And one day I got this long-distance call from Sacramento. I don't know how she heard about me. I got my phone number. And she said, "You're giving a Montessori course on Monday." I said, "Yeah." She says, "Can I come?" I said, "Yes." She moved out of her apartment on Saturday, got her stuff together on Sunday, drove all night Sunday night to get to Irvine, and was there before anybody else at 8 o'clock for the course on Monday morning. And you can see that Kaoru Suda is a very special person. But she's one of all the people that we trained there in the 86, 87, 88, 89. And those people stayed with that bilingual Montessori program in the public school system in Irvine until 2009. All the same teachers were there working with those children all those years until the school district decided they would close. I want to recognize Warren McPherson. Put your hand up, Warren. Most people know you anyway. My good friend and colleague. He's the owner and director of the Athens Montessori School. It's one of the best Montessori schools in the state. And if you want to see a good school, go visit his school. Now I want to recognize my wonderful friend, Alexandra Franco, there, yeah, who was her husband, wishing me a happy day on the screen, on the film. And yesterday he called me from a plane. He was on his way to Spain, and he calls me from a plane to wish me happy birthday. He's a wonderful friend. And Alex has also been all these years. She owns a very successful home to Montessori School in San Jose. And we have been colleagues and co-workers in preparing Montessori guides at our center there in Costa Rica. Is it 22 years now? There goes the cane. I'll just push it out of the way. Thank you. The graduates of our programs in Costa Rica have opened 25 Montessori schools in the area of San Jose. And now, Doctora Ina Rodriguez, ¿dónde estás? Ponte de pie, por favor. Ponte de pie. Dr. Ina Rodriguez is a professor at the University of Valladolid, Spain. And she came to be here at this event and to learn more about Montessori because we're working together to see if we can offer a Montessori teacher education program in Valladolid, a very special center that focuses upon the development of the environment. And it seems to us what could be better than to bring a Montessori program there, because Montessori is all about the environment. So welcome, we're happy to see you. Now, if you will permit me, I want to talk about second language acquisition. There are lots of people here who speak more than one language, which is very unusual, because usually I'll say, "Tout le monde parle français, n'est-ce pas?" No hands. Sprechen Sie Deutsch? Niemand?
Nein.
Algunos de ustedes hablan castellano? Oh, didn't happen. communicate in English?
Yes.
So that's what we have to do most of the time. What's a person who speaks six languages? Polyglot, is that the word? Polyglot. Five languages? I don't know. Four languages? Four languages? Tetralingual? No, tetralingual. Three languages? What is it called? Trilingual. Two languages? Five. One language? American. I'm sorry to say, because somehow the people in this country haven't learned how to do it. Like you do in Switzerland, and Finland, and England, and Italy, and all over the world. I have people on all of these social network connections from all over the world, from China, from Japan. They can all communicate with me in English. And it's easy to be able to communicate. But lots, not very many people can talk other languages with other people away from me. So I want to talk about dispelling myths about the second language acquisition with insights from the research. Is that up? Let's see. I want to share the input hypothesis. Here's the first one. Oh, by the way, Krashen's first name is Stephen with a PH. Stephen Krashen. I met him in 1984, I think it was. And we've been in touch and worked in conferences together. He is probably one of the world's foremost language, second language acquisition specialists and experts. Here's the first one. The acquisition learning hypothesis. Here's the second. The natural order hypothesis. The monitor hypothesis. The input hypothesis. And the affective filter hypothesis. Actually, these are no order hypotheses. These are facts. These are things that we know for sure about what happens when people are learning a second language. Here's the acquisition learning hypothesis. There are two independent ways of developing ability in a second language. Acquisition, that's the subconscious process that is exactly the same as the way that children acquire their first language. The other is learning, that's a conscious process that is the result of knowing about language. So when you're older, those of us who try to learn another language now, we do it now through learning rather than less, much less of the acquisition process that we had as children. The natural order hypothesis. We acquire the rules of language in a predictable order. Look at the date. Quarter, 1967, can tell you way back when that there's a predictable order in which we acquire the rules of language. Some rules come early, and others come late. The order is not based upon a progression from the simple to the complex. The order is different from the order in which rules of grammar are taught in language classes. The monitor hypothesis. The monitor hypothesis explains how acquisition and learning affect production. Our ability to speak in another language emerges from our subconscious knowledge. Learning is conscious knowledge. It only serves as an editor or monitor. We do this in English. We're saying something, and we use the wrong word, and we hear ourselves using the wrong word, and we correct it as we go along. But you do this all the more when you're learning a second language. The monitor can make corrections before we speak or write, or sometimes after we speak. Now the input hypothesis. This is the heart of this whole process of second language acquisition. Humans acquire language in only one way, by understanding messages, by receiving comprehensible input. We progress along the natural order hypothesis by understanding input that contains structures at our next stage. That is, structures a bit beyond our current level of competence. We talked about it this morning, the zone of proximal development that Vygotsky talks about. We move from I, which is input, our current level of competence, to I plus one, the next level along the natural order by understanding input containing I plus one. In other words, we have to constantly, and we do when we're dealing with young children, we do constantly give them input plus one because we're giving them language that they don't yet understand at first. Here are corollaries to the input hypothesis. Speaking is the result of acquisition, not the cause. Speech cannot be taught directly, but emerges on its own as a result of building confidence through comprehensible input. When there is enough comprehensible input, the necessary grammar is automatically provided. The teacher does not need to teach it. I've said to my teachers all the time, you don't have to teach grammar. If you speak grammatically correct English, your children will know how to speak it the rest of their lives. They don't have to know the rules. Who cares? As long as they're saying it correctly. Now here's a concept that came to us some time ago. The language acquisition device is being called. Comprehensible input is the essential environmental ingredient to language acquisition. However, the acquirer, that's you and me, does not acquire everything that she hears. The person's internal language processor or language acquisition device itself determines what will be acquired. That's Chomsky, Noam Chomsky. Look at the date, 1975. This brilliant linguist shared this thought about how our brains work. Long before we had the images of the brain, they could help us see how it's distributed. There are parts of the brain that are kind of a language detecting device, and they're the ones that are helping us understand and communicate. Now here's a very important element, particularly for children from other parts of the world. The affective filter. Comprehensible input alone is not enough. The acquirer needs to be open to the input. The affective filter is a barrier that prevents acquirers from acquiring all the comprehensible input they receive. Have you ever been in a very stressful situation where somebody's talking to you and you're so stressed you don't know what in the world they're saying? Have you had that happen? Yeah, I couldn't care less probably, but this happens in our lives. And this happens to a child who's been in a world where he doesn't understand a word they say. He's come from another country, he speaks another language at home, and he's out in the world and all this babble is going on around him and he doesn't know what it is. That's very stressful. And that stress itself prevents him from understanding even the things that he could understand. When the filter is up, the hearer may understand what he hears or reads, but the input will not reach his language acquisition device. Fear, anxiety, defensiveness, insecurity, all will raise the filter high, and very little will get through. Here is the fundamental principle in second language acquisition. People acquire a second language only if they obtain comprehensible input and if their affective filters are low enough to allow input in. Language acquisition is inevitable when the affective filter is down and enough comprehensible input is provided and comprehended. Here's a implications of second language acquisition theory. The most important element of language teaching program is input, not grammar. And what do we do when we teach second languages in the university? We teach grammar. Language acquisition can only take place when the focus is on what is being said. What is being said? Not the form of the language. Language is best taught when it is used to transmit messages, not when it is being taught for conscious learning. And vocabulary is important and needs to be plentiful. But grammar-based approaches limit vocabulary and concentrate on syntax instead of on comprehension. Let's talk about speaking. Learning to speak is an important goal, but speaking is not absolutely necessary for language acquisition. We acquire language from what we hear and understand, not from what we say. Those of you who have gone through a process of acquiring another language know that You're understanding a lot, but boy, it's harder to get it out to be able to say it yourself. Comprehension comes before production, during the silent of pre-production period. The same silent period every child passes through. Babies are passing through the silent period from birth until they finally begin babbling and begin sharing, trying to say words. Speech emergence, that's the early production period, comes next. Skills develop gradually. They begin with single word or phrase responses in a rich context embedded environment. Now here's a theoretical framework. Communicative proficiency can be conceptualized among two continua, context embedded versus context reduced communication, and cognitively undemanding versus cognitively demanding communication. That sounds very complicated, doesn't it? Let's take a look at it another way. The following figure helps us to see this a little bit better. Can you see the quadrants? At the top we have cognitively undemanding, and over to the left we have context embedded. That's the easy part. Boy, when we're there, we know exactly what's being said. But as we move from the A quadrant down to the D quadrant, look what's on over there. There it's cognitively demanding, and context reduced makes it very much more difficult to understand and speak. Context-embedded communication. Participants can actively negotiate meaning by providing feedback that they have not understood. The language is supported by a wide range of paralinguistic gestures, intonation, objects, reality, and situational cues. So teachers who work with children of second language must be able to do this. They must be able to help to monitor and be sure that the children are understanding what they're saying. Context-reduced communication relies primarily, or even exclusively, on linguistic cues to meaning. It can even involve suspending knowledge of the real world in order to interpret the logic of communication appropriately. Here is a comparison of the two. Cognitive continuum moves downward as the acquirer increases the amount of information he or she is able to process simultaneously or in close succession. In the upper part of the continuum, the linguistic tools that are required have been largely mastered. At the lower end of the continuum are tasks and activities in which the linguistic tools are not automatic and thus require active cognitive involvement. Now, people used to think that this is the way you work with languages. You have one place in your brain where you have one language proficiency, you have another place in your brain you have a second language proficiency. But that's not the way it is. This is more the way, if we use this image of it, that there is a common underlying proficiency. By the way, for which, as creatures of development, evolution and development, we are pre-designed